This morning with extending a sincere apology to those of you whose phone blew up on Friday from me. I am so sorry. So here's what happened. On Thursday, I just had this overwhelming, I was thinking about stuff I was thankful for, and truly at the top of my list was y'all. And so I bring out this app I have that allows me to send you, hey, I need somebody to bring up the house lights, please. And I wanted to just send a happy Thanksgiving, love you all on Thursday. And I've got an app to do that. And the beauty about the app is that if you were to reply, it doesn't go to everybody else on the group, you know, because that's what blows up phones. And I know how I feel when I get caught in, you know, just a group of maybe 10 people or so. And, you know, in the app, I've got like, you know, 168 of y'all that I was sending out a happy Thanksgiving to. And the app didn't work because it's not being supported well. It's one of those freebies. But not to worry, I had a second app on Thursday. And so I put the same message in the second app, tried to send it, and it failed as well for the same reason. It's not being supported anymore. And unfortunately, that ignited my clinical OCD at that point. And so I spent pretty much the rest of my Thanksgiving afternoon researching what kind of app would actually work, and particularly it has that feature in it that I would welcome replies, but I don't want the replies to go to everybody in the group because, well, y'all would hate me if I did that, understandably. So, I couldn't find an app, and then Friday finally rolled around, and my OCD is still at work, and I'm still looking, and I come across this README app, and boy, it's got, you know, over a million users, and it's got 5 stars, it seemed like the ticket. So I downloaded the app, and unfortunately there wasn't any instructions, and peculiarly, even YouTube didn't really have any helpful information to, you know, how to operate this app. So I thought, well, I'll just use a little common sense and take it step by step, and I'll figure it out as I go. So first step was to take my entire contact list and enter it into README app. And I did that. And then I'm kind of poking around looking for, okay, now, you know, I was looking for that feature that didn't allow your reply to go to the entire group. And while I'm searching around for that, next thing I know, boom, this thing sends an invite to all of you, which I did not, I did not push a button for that to happen. It just so happened Colleen's phone was right next to mine, and then all of a sudden it's just bing, 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 for like 15 minutes. Some of you know what I'm talking about, you know? You were hating me in your heart, weren't you? I was hating me in my heart. Because here's the ironic thing. The very thing that I was trying to avoid, my phone was totally silent. All of yours were the ones that were going off. It was a complete 180 of what was supposed to happen. So, I do apologize for that. I want to be in more contact with you to kind of remind you guys of things that are going on and just to say I love you from time to time and to communicate with you. So I have not given up, and so let me apologize in advance that it could happen again. Because my OCD has mellowed out a little bit, but it's still, the energy is still there. And even without that, it's something that I just want to do. I want to be able to communicate with you guys, and I don't want you guys to be irritated as I do that because 168 of us are responding to each other's replies. So I'm still kind of dialing all of that in, and I'll keep you posted on how it's going. One thing I will also say is that if you're sitting here and you're like, I have no idea what he's talking about, I didn't get that message, that's probably because I don't have you in my contact list. So that number that we show for first-timers to communicate, that is actually my cell phone number. So what I'd like you to do is that if you didn't have the enjoyment of your phone blowing up, you don't want to miss it next time. And so I would like you, but instead of new, I'd like you to put your name. And please send that to me. I've got my phone on silent over there, so hopefully, because it would be good for you to get the text done the right way eventually. So we have a special guest with us here today, and I'm going to be bringing them up in a moment. Stephanie and Alan Moroney, and they are actually the kids of Bill and Marie Eddy, who were with us here earlier this year, our missionaries to Spain. They're also missionaries in Spain as well, but they have a very unique ministry. And I love what they're doing, and you, Living Hope, have been supporting them for the last 3 years. I'm so grateful. You know, we're one of the few churches I know of that give, you know, close to 20% away every month just to take the gospel to the four corners of the earth. We will do that. It has come at sacrifice at times where, you know, the staff has over the years taken, you know, three or four, you know, cuts in pay just to keep the lights on. But we will not cut the budget to our missionaries. We keep that going as best we can. And it's all because of your generosity. And so I just want to say thank you for being faithful in your obedience to the Lord in giving. It's because of your faithfulness that we're able to support ministries like what the Moronis are doing, who will be joining me up here in a moment for a little Q&A time. But I was thinking about particularly their ministry and how in keeping it was with Jesus' ministry. Just a quick story of from the scripture of what Jesus had shared early on in his ministry. His name has now become somewhat well known. He's still early in his ministry, but the scriptures teach us that, you know, his name was known throughout the region. He's well underway in his miracle working ministry. He's teaching in synagogues each and every Sabbath rest that he comes to. And then there's this story that Luke captures, a very interesting story, when Jesus returns. Not sure if it was his first time, but it's the first recorded time that after he began his public ministry, he returns to his hometown. Not, of course, the town where he was born, but the town Nazareth, where he was raised. And what's interesting is that this is where he really gives what I would consider to be his mission statement, where he encapsulates very clearly what he was all about. And so Luke picks this up beginning at verse 16, and he says, he went to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, and as was his custom, and he stood up to read. Now you have to kind of understand some history among that. The main thing Luke wants you to know here now is that, hey, he's well known in this group. It's the synagogue that he had grown up with. Everyone in the room knows it. In fact, if we were to jump ahead to verse 22, you would see where Luke captures that, where, hey, isn't this the son of Joseph the carpenter? And so he's well known. And there's a cultural practice that's being mentioned here where when someone is either new to the synagogue or someone of significant new to the synagogue, they would oftentimes ask that individual to take, you know, the scroll and read a portion of the Torah, read a portion of the law or the prophets. And so that's exactly what's happening here. He goes on in verse 17. It says, the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it was written. He found the place. In other words, the tradition, the culture was that the leader of the synagogue would actually tell you what portion of the scripture that you were to be read. And Jesus kind of blows that off and says, no, I got a better idea. Let me share with you really what's on my heart and mind to say here. And now we get to what he actually said. And this is connected to what the Moronis do. He says this. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of the sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And of course, he's quoting from Isaiah 61. It was a very familiar passage in a Jewish person's mind, probably one of the better known passages. Most people there might have been able to actually recite it by heart. They knew this passage because it was a reference to the coming Messiah that would one day come. It's a favorite passage because every Jewish person knew something from experience or from not too long ago history. Every Jewish person knew something about being poor. They knew something about being a prisoner, about something about being blind and oppressed. This was a familiar reality for their lives. Ancient history documents very well that although God wanted to bless his people were oftentimes found in bondage and slavery and oppression simply because of their rebellion, their unwillingness to surrender to God and to live that life that's pleasing to God. And but of course, when you rebel against God, you kind of step out of God's favor, correct? And that's what's happening. And it was true in Jesus' time as well. Ancient history shows Israel over and over and over again being exiled. And in this case, that wasn't an exile that the people were living in, but they knew about oppression because they were under the oppression of Rome. Rome had come in and had really removed any status of being a sovereign nation, which was very important to the average Jew. And not only that, but Roman's taxation system was severe and crippling. Pretty much everybody, except for maybe the tax collector, was now living in below the poverty line, barely making a living. That's what the oppression and slavery looked like at Jesus' time. And so Jesus' early popularity was, in fact, mostly based on the promise that he would come and deliver them from Roman rule, reestablish them as once again a sovereign nation, no longer under the oppressive hand of Rome. That's what they were all looking for. And so Jesus reads this passage from from Isaiah 61, and then he says this. Luke tells us that he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. Why were they fastened on him? I mean, that word fastened is intent, focused, expecting. It's kind of like, you know, there's a drum roll taking place here. They're expecting some kind of big response to this because, again, everyone was hoping that because of this miracle-working guy named Jesus, that maybe he would be the one that would set us free from Roman rule. And here he reads this very popular passage out of Isaiah of the hope of being freed by the power of the Messiah. And so they're all looking for, with anxious anticipation, for what he had to say next. And what he had to say was actually pretty profound. He said, he began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Which was actually the very best news. I mean, why everybody didn't stand up and applause at that moment might seem like a little bit of mystery, although if we were to read on in the passage, we'd discover that apparently a prophet has no honor at home. And so instead of being stood and applauded and yielded to and knees bowed to him, that's not how it played out. In fact, the response was, well, wait a minute now. This is Jesus, the son of Joseph the carpenter. And even though he was, in fact, their promised Messiah, he was the anointed Christ, he was the long-awaited deliverer, unfortunately, the audience here in Nazareth didn't hear the good news. Instead, what they did was they doubted, they did not believe, again, asking, well, wait a minute, isn't this Joseph the carpenter's son? And so what Luke says he began his response was really the greatest news that had ever been shared at that point. However, if we were to read on in this story, you would realize that within minutes of Jesus making this statement, this group is now hustling him to the edge of a cliff, ready to throw him over the cliff within minutes of saying this. Now, that's a different sermon for a different day. The point I wanted to share in this is simply that Jesus states very clearly that he was and he is still in the business of proclaiming good news to the poor. Amen? He was and still is in the business of proclaiming freedom for prisoners, providing sight for the blind, setting free those who are oppressed, proclaiming favor to all who would follow him. And so today, this ministry of freedom happens by the person of the Holy Spirit working in and through any and all who are making themselves available towards such ends. Now, I realize we can't all be out there on the mission field. However, we do have with us Alan and Stephanie, who are on that mission field, and we get to share in the glories of what they're doing because we support them. And so I want to ask you all to come forward here. We're going to do a little Q&A here. Tell us a little bit about what you do. Let's welcome them, would you? Okay. And Olivia. The cutest baby ever. Well, to begin with, grab the mic there and tell us a little bit about yourselves so we get to know you.
Well, to start, we wanted to thank you guys for having us here and also for supporting us for the past 3 years in prayer and also finances. It made me cry a couple times this week thinking about how y'all have been a part of our ministry without really knowing us as a family. I mean, a lot of you knew me as a child, but it's been such an honor and a privilege to meet you guys and to spend a few days with the pastors in. Alan was saying something, you don't know I'm going to say that, but he was saying something during worship that I want him to share with you guys.
Okay, I'll take Miss Olivia.
She's so wise, isn't she cute?
Yeah. She's
adorable.
Hi, hello, my name is Alan. My English is not that good. I'm Brazilian, originally from Brazil, but living in Spain for 8 years now as a missionary. And what she wants me to say is, I told her during the worship time, I was reading the lyrics of the songs, and I remember that someone from the past, some famous guy, he once said, show me the lyrics of your country, and you don't need to tell me your loss, because through the lyrics, I can understand how your country works. And when I read the lyrics, it came to my mind that I can see how this church is a blessing through the lyrics, because the songs are not about me receiving from the Lord, but about Him transforming me, breaking me, crushing me, and making new wine out of me. So I just loved it, and I can see that this is a blessing to this city and to the people around just by the lyrics. So thank you. Thank you for your lyrics and for following what Jesus really asked us and told us to do.
Amen. Amen.
Well, as you asked to tell about ourselves, so I'm Brazilian. I was born and raised in Brazil. When I was 18, I left Brazil to play soccer. I tried to be a professional soccer player, and my manager took me to Spain, where I did some trials there. Long story, but I didn't play well, so they didn't like my skills, and they said, "Hey, you can go back home." And it's a funny story now. It was terrible at that time. But that was the way I got to meet the Lord. When I was there and they said no, my manager who sent me there abandoned me and left me alone in Spain. I didn't speak any Spanish. I didn't know anyone there. I didn't have any money. I didn't have a credit card to go back home. I remember I had in my wallet something like, I don't know, 40 cents of dollars or something like that. And that was the time when I just cried and said, "Lord, if you exist, please help me and save me." And the next day I was flying home. Many miracles happened that day. And then I realized that I wanted to give my life to Him. And after that, I kept trying to play soccer. It didn't happen. I went to Spain for the last time, and I said, "I'm going to try to play soccer one more time. If it doesn't work, I'm going to stop. I'm going to go back home and work with my dad." And I went there. It didn't work again. So I was about to go back to Brazil, and a friend of mine said, "Hey, why don't you become a missionary you love to travel, you love God, you love to work with the church, so you should be a missionary. And they said, that's a good idea, I'm going to try that. So I sent an email to youth with a mission. I don't know if you know about that. And I went there and did a school with them. And then I have been a missionary for the last 8 years now. And I got to marry this beautiful girl. And now we have a beautiful daughter. And this is a little bit about me.
Cool. Yeah, I was going to say so the particular type of ministry that Alan and Steffi are involved in is the whole subject of human trafficking. And boy, you know, I mean, I know the bold headlines of what human trafficking is about, but really I wasn't all that familiar with any of the particulars and, you know, exactly how all of that works and stuff. And so I thought, well, it'd be good for them, because they're actually doing the work in human trafficking, to kind of educate us a little bit on, you know, what human trafficking is and how it works and a little bit about that whole subject.
Okay, well, I started working with human trafficking victims 8 years ago. And what it is the exploitation of people without their consent, or if they give their consent, it's because they're being coerced.
Coerced, yep.
There's different types of trafficking depending on where you look up the information, but there's sex trafficking, labor trafficking, child soldiers, and organ trafficking. We focus more on sex trafficking because in Spain, in the world, the majority of victims are sex trafficking victims, and in Spain, there's mostly sex trafficking and labor trafficking, but we have specialized in working against sex trafficking.
Mm. And what was it that initially got you interested in that?
So in Spain, prostitution is illegal. So it's not illegal, but it's not legal either. Anyone can sell themselves, but they can't have anyone who is obtaining benefits from that exploitation. So that never happens. There's always someone who's benefiting. So where I grew up in Madrid, and we have a lot of roundabouts. And in every roundabout, growing up, I would see girls there. And and I would ask my parents, you know them, they're very open. So they would tell me what they were doing. And there was always something in my heart that was, that would burn for them. And I remember when I was little, I was 6 or 7, and thinking, when I grow up, I have to do something. I want to do something about this. And I had to wait till I was 19. So many years, so until I was able to do something. I started working at a safe house for women that had been rescued, and then I worked on the street, on the track, to try to rescue them. And then when we got married and moved to the north of Spain with YWAM, we started a ministry there. But the way Alan came into contact, so there's one way that I was always been passionate about it, and then there's another way that people can start in this ministry, and I think it's interesting because we're polar opposites.
Well, it's not that I didn't care about the subject, but I never had the feeling or the passion to work with that until I get to know Steffi, and her passion became my passion. Just by listening to her and listening to the reality, I thought, well, I need to do something as well, even though I don't feel like, you know, from when I was a kid, I didn't feel anything for the subject. So I just by seeing her and seeing her passion, I started to be passionate about it as well. And that's how I started to work with this subject.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just pictured you, the little girl. Mommy, Daddy, what's that girl doing out on the street there? Yikes, awkward.
Not for my parents.
Your folks just tell it like it is. So I'm curious. I mean, what would be like a typical story of how someone becomes a victim? I mean, how do they get caught into the world of sex trafficking?
Right. So in all of human trafficking, the traffickers use the same methods to lure girls and men. The majority, I think it's like 75% of the victims are women. So they use the same tactics. When you think about it, you normally think that they're abducted, and that's normally not the case. Because of social media right now and our access to information so quickly and to different people, the main way that people are lured is through the lover boy method. I don't know if you've seen the movie Taken from way long ago. That's kind of the way. I was talking to Colleen the other day, every teenage girl is vulnerable because our identity and our self-esteem is starting to build. So what every girl wants is to feel loved. So this person, this good-looking guy will come and start making, like, investing and saying, like, affirming you and maybe taking you out to eat or getting you clothes, trying to become like your boyfriend. So that's they build trust. It's a process. They build trust, and you finally trust this person, and they will take you, like the movie. So they'll say, let's go out, and you go out because you trust this person. You've seen them for months, and you think that they're trustworthy, and then they bring you in. One of the easiest ways for them to do it is that they'll befriend you, and then once you trust them, they'll take you to on a date or to a party at their house. You get to the house, there's no one there, only him and a couple friends who, I'm trying to think of a word without for the kids to be. So they do things there to bind you, and you feel like you have nothing, you can't do anything, so they say you have to now sell your body. Or a way that the Romanian girls are with their pareja? No, their like their spouse or their boyfriend, they'll say, I'm needing money, can you go out and sell your body? And you don't feel like you have an option. So mostly that's the way.
Mm. Wow.
Yeah. I just want to add one thing. It can take months for them to do this, but it can also take one day. There is a lot of victims that in one day, the first contact that they had with the girl or the boy, and within 24 hours, they are already a victim of this. So it can happen very fast.
So fathers, when your young daughters are beginning to enter womanhood and a boy is sweet on them, you should take them out quickly. Break out the gun. Okay. So tell us a little bit about what it is exactly you guys do, working in the trafficking ministry.
Okay, there's a short 1.5 minute video that will show you in images what we're doing, and there's a voiceover. The first part is in Spanish, but it has subtitles, and the second part, the voiceover, is in English. And then after that, we'll explain a little bit more about what we're doing.
Hay 45,5 millones de esclavos en el mundo.
Solo un 1% es liberado.
El 90% de las mujeres que ejercen la prostitución en España lo hacen obligadas.
4 de cada 10 hombres en España han consumido prostitución.
La prostitución en España mueve más de 5 millones de euros al día.
España es el tercer destino de turismo sexual en el mundo.
Pero hay esperanza.
In the last 2 years, we have trained and brought awareness to more than 500 people. We've met and given follow-up to more than 50 women, given out more than 50 kits, taken 2 women off of the streets, and done 3 rescues. We've walked alongside one girl who wanted to give her life to Christ, seen many miracles, and accompanied 7 women as they gave steps closer to the Lord. But there's still so much more to do. Will you help us?
So that's a little. Well, I don't see any of you, but you're there. That's a little bit of what we do. I don't know if you saw that we take a little crate, and in that crate there's coffee, there's milk, there's tea. That's why our ministry is called Coffee and Hope, because in Spain, when you want to get to know someone, you take them out for coffee. We can't do that with our girls because they're trapped. So we take the coffee to them. And the hope part is because we want to bring hope to them. They are one of the Spain's worst people. People don't have any consideration for them. They don't see them as people. So we want to bring hope to them that there is hope for them. There's a way out. And also we want to introduce to them the hope, who is Jesus. So what we do is we take that little crate and we befriend them. We go out every Monday night. We have a team of 6 people right now. We've been more in the past. We've had a couple bajas, people who stopped coming to the ministry because it's very taxing. So it's a ministry that you need. You just need to be willing to suffer a lot. And so we have girls and we have guys. The guys are always our drivers and our protectors. We've had some self-defense training. So the guy will never make contact, our guys will never make contact with the girls because every man is a potential client. They are tired of hearing pastors even come and preach the gospel to them one day and the next night come and buy them. So in this phase of where we work in the rescue phase, the guys are only in the car protecting us. So we will come down out of the car, introduce ourselves. In Spain, you say hello like this. So we do that with the girls because same with homeless people. They don't feel a lot of physical touch except, of course, for exploitation. So we try to be as normal with them as you would with anyone else. We even took Olivia to them when she was born, and it was they loved it. So we give out coffee. We give out they kits. Cried. Yeah, they cried. They were so excited. We give out kits. I think you saw a little bit. It has like basic hygiene products. We have to give them things that the pimps won't take away. So we can't give them anything that will present as a threat to the pimps. So we try to be as low-key as possible. They need to bathe, so the pimp won't buy it. We give it to them.
Right.
And we also, we've given out Bibles. We had one girl who we gave a Bible to. She was Spanish. And a few months went by, and she came up to us and she said, "Can I have another Bible?" This has never happened to me. As a Spaniard, no one has ever asked me for a Bible. She said, "I've been reading it every night, and I moved, and I went to read it last night, and I couldn't find it. So can you please bring me another one?" Mm. We went into the car and cried. Yeah. So that's basically our tactic. It's a very long, you have to invest, and we go out every week so that they can gain trust. It doesn't serve them anything if you go out one day and then don't go back. That sometimes in Spain, what people will do, a church will come out or do a one-time event with the girls. That really doesn't help them as much as it helps us feel like we've done a good job. So we go out every week and invest in the girls.
Yeah. And when you mentioned the protection thing, that would be primarily from the pimp? That would be?
The pimps and the clients. We've had clients try to run us over.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So there's certain ways that we were trained to like stand. So if the girl is here, we'll try to stand like this. I'm seeing what's happening in your back. You're seeing what's happening in my back. The guy is always seeing us through the mirrors. We have certain signals that if we're in danger, he'll put the emergency lights on. That means that we need to get out of there. Get out of there. Something I forgot to say is that we offer them prayer. When we started going out in 2016, no one wanted prayer. They just wanted the coffee, so we would leave because we don't want to put them in more danger. But after all this time, we have girls, some of our girls from Romania who are sex trafficking victims. They will now run towards us to get prayer, or they will leave clients. They'll say that they don't want, and that's a danger for them because the pimp will then come and say, "Why did you?" But they would prefer to come stay with us and be prayed for than go and do what they're forced to do.
Yeah, yeah. And I remember, I don't know if I was talking with you guys or with Colleen or something, but like social media and stuff, you guys try to keep your faces out of social media and all that because if you were identified.
We are the only, so we made a nonprofit, Coffee and Hope. We're the only nonprofit. We're the only people that are going out to see the girls.
Mm-hmm.
No one else in our region is doing it. So when we've done rescued, they know it's us. The pimps know it's because no one else is doing anything there.
Right.
So we try to be as low-key as possible. We don't have a website. We don't have Instagram, which is detrimental in one way because people can't find us easily.
Right.
But we would prefer to be protected and protect the girls and the ministry than maybe be more public. We've had different events that we've done, and we always try to not be the face of the event.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
Give someone else, because it could be a danger.
Yeah, if your face was identified as the key people who bring help to these girls, you could be mm-hmm. taken out.
Because we pose as stupid church people who don't know anything. Mm-hmm. When in reality, we're specialized in this. We know everything. But that doesn't present as a threat to the pimps. Mm-hmm. We just come out as like, oh, you want some coffee? And in reality, we know all the everything that's going on in the background. We have different indicators that we know if someone's sex trafficking. We work with the police force. But you need to have like a cover.
Gotcha. Gotcha. Yeah. So those of you taking pictures, don't put it on your Facebook, okay?
Or at least don't put where we work.
Right. Right. Okay. Last question. How can we help?
Okay. There is a small video that I want to play. It's a video from the movie Moana in Disney. The movie has nothing to do with what we are doing, but there's a short clip where the bad guy or the bad girl is like enraged, and Moana starts singing to her about who she is. So you'll see like the crazy, creepy monster, and Moana starts singing, "This is not who you are. Your heart has been stolen from inside you, but this does not define you." And it's just a short clip, and then we'll explain with a few more words what you can do.
Okay. Lights, please.
Tafiti, it's gone.
Let her come to me.
I have crossed the horizon to find you. Does not define you. This is not who you are. You know who you are. Who you truly are.
So I like to use this clip because that's how Jesus feels about us and about the girls. Society sees the girls as monsters, but we know who they are. God knows who they are, and that's what we are doing, and that's what you guys can do too. We can treat them as people. We can love on them and make them realize who they are, in even though their heart has been stolen and they've created all these layers of protection. So what y'all can do and that you're already doing is pray for the people that are working in this in this ministry, give, you also are doing it. And the main thing I would say is when you see these people, treat them as people. Treat them as someone who has dreams, passion, brothers and sisters, kids, like you'd want to be treated. And we've had girls who have, we've been able to rescue some girls. Some of them have been minors. One of the girls, she was calloused like that, like the monster, and she is now in a safe house, going to school, has met the Lord, and is thriving and flourishing. So I would just encourage you to keep on doing what you're doing and find ways that you can serve these women in ways that dignifies them.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, thank you, you guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. When I was talking to Stephanie and she was telling me about that clip, it just, I could hardly watch it without crying. And she talked about how these poor girls have been victimized. What did you say? If a woman is raped once, it takes her a lifetime to recover. And these girls have had this happen to them over and over again. And but Jesus is there too. Tell them who they really are. And these guys are faithful to be his hands and his heart extended to them.
Mm-hmm. So they have just arrived here in the United States and are going to be spending the next 3 months going traversing across the country to other churches that support them and with family and friends, just a little bit, I learned about your schedule. I'm thinking we should pray for you all to have strength and stamina, bringing a newborn baby along in tow. They're going to need some God-given strength and stamina for the few months that are ahead. So I tell you what, let's go down here and pray. And I'd like some of my prayer warrior folks to come up front and let's pray blessing over